This is an interesting passage we have here this morning, and it's probably maybe not one that a lot of us know. Right? The story we had last week was God calling Moses from the burning bush, right? And he sent Moses where? To Pharaoh. And what was he supposed to go to Pharaoh and do? Tell Pharaoh to let my people go, right? So he went to Pharaoh and Pharaoh didn't listen, and what happened? The plagues. How many plagues were there? I hear 7. I hear 10. I hear... How many were there? 28. Did somebody say 28? 14? Bingo. There were 10 of them. I'm not going to ask you what they are. Right? There was frogs and there was flies and there was water turning to blood and there was all these other nasty things. But the 10th one happens actually just after a special event. The 10th one was, does anyone know what the 10th one was? The death of all of the firstborn. That's all of the firstborn in Egypt. Not just humans, but animals. All of the firstborn were killed. And what saved the Israelites? The lamb's blood. From what? The first Passover. Right? So, the Israelites kill a lamb, they spread the blood over the doorpost, and that keeps the angel of death from coming and killing their firstborn. The firstborn are all dead in the land, and Pharaoh finally calls Moses in and says, get your people out of here before all of us die. So they go out, and they cross, and then Pharaoh changes his mind, chases after them, they get to the Red Sea, or the Sea of Reeds. We know it as the Red Sea, the crossing of the Red Sea, right? And Moses takes his staff and he splits the water. You think how awesome that would be? How many Israelites are walking on this dry land in the seabed and you could see the fish swimming next to you as you're walking? It'd be terrifying and awesome all at the same time, right? You're like, is this water going to come crashing down on me at any time here? But you walk through and the Israelites get through and then Moses does his thing and the waters come back down and kill all Pharaoh's men. Right? So now they're wandering through the wilderness, and we get to this time where they're complaining because they're hungry, right? First question, how long have they been in the wilderness? You would think it's a month and a half.
40 days and 40 nights.
No, not yet. At this point in time, how long have they been in the wilderness? I had an answer over here.
15 days.
A month and a half. A month and a half. I have 15 days. It says here, the whole congregation of Israel sent out from Elam, and Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, and on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. So the 15th day of the second month, so they departed 1 month, and now they're to the 15th day of the second month, so you would think it's a month and a half. It's only a month. It's actually less than a month they've been in the wilderness, and they have complained to God 3 times already. Parents, can you relate? Are we there yet? Right? And the reason that I can say it's a month, we have to go back and look. But you're right. I mean, that's a good... That's what it says. It's the 15th day of the second month. You think it'd be a month and a half. That's good math. But here's the thing. We've got to go back, right? We said that the 10th plague happened on the day after the day of the first Passover. And the first Passover occurred when? That's the day that they left, right? Just to make this perfectly clear. They left the first day of they left the day of the first Passover, the night of the first Passover. And that happened when? God came to them, to Moses, in Exodus chapter 12, and he said, go to the people and tell them that this is the first month of the year. And on this month you shall celebrate, and on the 10th day of this month you shall go take a lamb, one for your family, one without blemish, one that you can share with maybe another family if there's not as many people in the next family. Find a group of people that can share a lamb, and get that lamb on the 10th day of the month, and keep that lamb until the 14th day of the month. And at twilight you shall kill that lamb, and you shall spread its blood over the doorpost. So what day does Passover occur? The 15th. Because you have to remember, Jewish days start at sundown till next sundown. So if you're killing it at twilight on the 14th, it actually starts, then Passover starts, and this is the 15th of the month. So they did the Passover the 15th of the first month, and here this is the second month, the 15th day. So they've been in the wilderness now for 1 month. And they're complaining about the fact that God set them free, but we're hungry. Right? How many of you ever been hangry? Right? That's that combination of hungry and angry. Because I'm so hungry that I'm angry, so I'm hangry, right? The Snickers, I should have had Snickers bar up here. They were complaining to God. And so God finally said, okay. But here's the thing that we don't get about that, right? In this day and age, in Moses' day and age, when people would complain to God or complain about the gods, what would happen to them? What would the gods do to them? What?
Smite them?
Yeah, exactly. The God would kill them. You didn't complain to God, because if you complained to God, you would die. And Moses is writing this, or the people that wrote this to the Israelites are trying to remind them that our God is not like everybody else's God. Our God can take a little complaint every now and then. Our God listens to us. Our God actually wants to be in a personal relationship with us. You see, this text is about us talking to God and asking Him for what we need. Right? And then what does God do when we ask Him for what we need?
He answers.
He gives it to us. He gives us what we need, not what we want all the time, right? Because this text is about God being in a relationship with us. It's about God being there with us, day in and day out, providing for the needs of us as we travel through our wilderness, right? It's about trust in God. It's about us trusting God to know that we're going to get what we need. Because God provided them with... What did He provide them with? Bread. But what is the bread called? Manna. Do you know where manna, the word manna comes from?
Hebrew.
What?
Hebrew.
Hebrew.
Right.
That is correct. Do you know what the word manna in Hebrew means?
What is it?
Yeah, I'm asking. What is it? They don't get that, but that's okay. That's the answer, actually. Manna is actually, what is it? When the Israelites went out and saw this bread-like substance on the ground, which I can only equate to, if you've ever had your house toilet paper, and you try to pick up wet toilet paper off the grass, that's what manna is. And if that's never happened to you, just be happy that that's never happened to you. Right? But it's like picking up wet toilet paper off of grass is what this fine substance is. But manna literally means Israelites went out and said, what is it? They saw it and they didn't know what it was. So they said, manna, what in the world is it? It's bread that God provides, right? God didn't necessarily give them the best thing. Because they remembered about slavery. What did they remember? All the great food we got to eat as we sat around the flesh box and we ate our fill of all of that great food. They didn't remember the beatings and the being told what to do all the time and everything else that came with being a slave. They remembered the good stuff. Because that's where we get to, right? We get set in our lives and we get set in our ways and we understand how things are going to happen and we have this grand plan for everything that's going to be. And then God changes something. And we have to trust. God set these people free and sent them out into the wilderness to send them to the land that He was going to send them to. And He told them, I'm going to give you bread and I'm going to give you quails. And you can only gather as much as you need. No more. Right? It says at the bottom of the text that those who gathered more didn't have any more. And those that gathered less had enough that they need. They had an omer. How much is an omer? It's as much as you need. An omer is a tenth of an ephah. And an ephah is equal to a bushel. So an omer is basically a tenth of a bushel. It's how much bread they had for a day. And if they gathered more actually tried to keep more, what happened to it? It doesn't tell us in our text today, but it tells us a little bit beyond this, that if they gathered more and they kept it, the next morning it was filled with maggots. And it was spoiled. So they couldn't keep anymore. They had to trust in God. They had to put their lives into God's hands. And it's not easy for us to understand that, is it? How many of you have ever had to put your lives completely into God's hands? If you had to do this, it's an experience that you need to share with other people. Because it's something that if we've never had to do that, we don't understand. Because we plan our lives out and we know how things are going to happen. And when it comes to that point where you have to just give up and say, okay, God, whatever is going to happen is going to happen. And I trust you. It's a scary thing. It's like standing on this step and not knowing if there's a step below me and I'm going to step down or not. But I still trust in God because God is telling me to move forward. So I know that no matter what happens, that I'm not going to fall. And even if I do, God's going to be there to pick me up. Because that's what this text is about. This text is about us laying our lives into God's hands and not knowing what's going to happen tomorrow. Other than the fact that God is going to provide me with the manna that I need. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know how I'm going to provide. I don't know what's going to be of the lives of the people that I'm supposed to be taking care of. But I know that God is going to be there. And I know that God is going to provide me what I need. And by providing me what I need, He's going to provide for those who I need. It's about laying our lives in God's hands. And knowing that it's not always going to be the way that you want it to be. You're not always going to have everything that you want. But God is going to make sure that you have everything that you need. And if we can live in what God gives us, we can show the world an abundance that they can't possibly imagine. So set your lives in God's hands. And know that with even all of the stuff that's happening in this world, and all of the unknowns in every one of our lives, that if we can place our lives in God's hands and trust that He's always going to give us what we need, that our life will be way better than we could ever possibly plan it to be. And He will send us to do many great things to show His love to all of us. So trust God. Knowing He's always going to give you exactly what you need.